Hello and welcome to another episode in the Capture series, part 2, chapter 2, and here we start. But before I start, I want to give you a little head up. I know most people think everything is in metadata and we are fine, so we don't have to make this survey data. And survey data is the main theme here. And I know this is the most boring part from the whole Capture series. I know. Survey data, just numbers and words and nothing fancy in the images. And the truth is, you do not improve the images by just writing stuff down, but you improve the value of the images on the long run, because in a moment you join maybe a team and the team has always to ask you, what was the data here? What is the size? What was the light? And so on. You lose time each time you get this question. And if it is only 1 minute and this is every day, you will notice that the metadata that you have maybe attached to the image is just pure value by itself. So before I go here now and tell you what I think is important, because you might have a different idea, but I can give you here only a start point where you develop then your own system, of course. The texture shooting advice, and I think I repeat here something from the theoretical part. Before you start, what is needed? That might be a project that you have already, or that might be something because you have time on your hand and you say, okay, today I go out and shoot something, because I missed in the last projects always some of the themes here. Maybe a hedge, maybe some concrete, maybe some tar, whatever. So in the moment you can't say what you want, you are already a step further at least, because then you can search for it and you know what to look for. The first step is, of course, not the camera, it's the lens in my point. And if you know the lens, then you can write something down. For example, here for these cases, 200 millimeter, and it was a 2.8 lens, a zoom lens. Maybe you put a set in it. Then you can say the f-stop 3.5. F means, for example, fraction. And so the bigger the number, the higher the fraction, the less light comes in. But there's a sweet spot. We come to that sweet spot later on. When you have maybe this image here and you have this distance here measured, it's always a good idea to get it, but you could also go here from the color chart and say, I know the size and so I can interpolate or extrapolate the size here. That's nice to know. And if I say the camera was maybe in this distance, when I pretend the camera was here, then I know this distance, I know this, and then I have here already an angle of view or a view angle. And this gives me already some math to finally get the lens length back if I know the camera. But of course, if I have written down all of this, it's very nice to have. Then no out-of-wide balance. That's a shooting advice, but also write it down, because it's very important to know if you have set this maybe to the little sun symbol and it was an overcast day. In the raw material, that makes nearly no difference, of course, but there is that little histogram on the camera and that reacts with this setting here. And that can change, of course. When you have a lot of blue in the scene and you have set it to sun, it will be different than when you have a lot of yellow in the scene, for example. So this histogram is not raw based in most DSLRs. It's maybe raw based in a red camera, but not in a DSLR. So there's a big difference sometimes. Have an eye on that, know your camera, and you're better off. This information is critical for the work on set, and I would note it down what you have used for that, just to have it complete. It's not important, because you should use RAW anyway, and the white balance setting is not so important. It's only during the shot. Always exposure bracketing shots, because then you get the camera response curve out. You remember these curves, three on top of each other, then an algorithm is maybe able to get a straight line out of it and you linearize everything. So maybe two stops or one stop apart, and the middle one should be the one that has maybe an histogram like this, where you have no blacks, no highlights, clamped or clipped or crashed. This would be the ideal. Then use the lowest ISO. This is of course also only when the ISO is burned into the RAW, which is mostly the case with DSLRs. In some film cameras, even if they are usable for images as well, ISO might be just metadata. There are different concepts on the market, but again, most DSLRs have just burned in ISO and they react with that setting very heavily in the way they store the material. Totally different concepts are available. So this number should be, for example, 100, because the lower it is, the more light you have to put on the sensor, and the more light the sensor is hitting, then the less noise you have. Normally, know your camera. Again, I repeat myself here. So write this down and make some tests when the camera behaves in the best way, which with ISO setting. Shoot RAW, as I said before, and I will go into RAW versus JPEG again in an extra episode because I think it's very important to know. Then shoot perpendicular and orthographic. So here I have the camera from the side. That's of course wrong. It should be pretty much here and then inset in the distance that we have when the view axis hits that surface. We have a 90 degree angle here. Perpendicular and orthographic is a pair that I put here on point number 6. Use a tripod, and the tripod itself is something that is normally underneath of the camera, and it gives you always a specific height, and this height should be also noted just in case of. I talked about the leveler on the camera, so you have that as well. And when you have set up the camera exactly in this way, the orthographic and perpendicular situation should be simple. And of course the tripod. Everything can be measured. And of course to make notes is very important, because the one who finally develops all your textures, maybe much later, is happy about any information that he can get or she can get, because there could be a red truck around the corner and there's a little color cast in it, so you can work on that. Or a big tree that has maybe a lot of green tint into the picture, maybe only in the shadows or so. Whatever is catching your attention, put it into the notes. It's maybe 1 second just to write it down, but it helps maybe to develop the material much faster. Survey snapshots. That means if you shoot from all sides here, and you note this, of course, when you say I have 3 snapshots here, 1, 2, and 3 from these directions, just to give you a little bit more information about the side or whatever catches again your attention is important. And to shoot snapshots with a digital camera is really not an effort whatsoever. Survey snapshots. Pretty much obvious to say that, but I have to mention it, of course. Then, of course, use the gray card or a color chart or perhaps both. And if you can't use the light that is directly on the set, you need maybe diffusion options or filters or just reflective material, artificial light, whatever. If the light that you have on the scene or on the set doesn't fit to your scene that you want to create in Cinema 4D, it should be flat, and that is my most preferred one. Of course, sometimes it's very helpful to have the light already baked into the texture, but this limits, of course, the use of it. So my preferred way is flat. No shadows, no specular, no highlights, nothing that gives finally a direction of the light already. When you have something that is just diffuse, you can use maybe bump or displacement or normal to get finally some light back into it. And that is then, of course, accordingly to your light setup in the scene. It's a much better way. Okay, then keep the scale of your project in mind. If you take a texture like this here and put it on a wall that is maybe 100 feet high, it loses its impact, even if it looks great on the first, but when you come closer to that and you see maybe the details inside, it's not really appealing. So always have the project in mind and the scale of it. We will go into that in detail, of course. But again, you should have that in your notes before you even start. What is needed? That's the point here, for example. So when you run and gun just for textures, this is maybe not really noticed, and you shoot maybe a lot of stuff that is not usable for the current project. Now, the sweet spot of the lens. I have discussed this, and for this lens it's relatively open. 3.5 gives me that already. I don't have even to go to 8 or so. 5.6 is also fine, but this lens is just fine, relatively wide open, and with the distance that I had here, it's fantastic. And you will find with your lens, of course, the sweet spot. We have discussed this, as I said, so have an eye on that, which f-stop is the best one. And of course, the shorter the exposure is, and that is of course based here on the ISO and on the f here, the exposure triangle, as the saying is, that is the last one you should consider. But it should be also short, because when it's too long, chances are, if you're on a bridge like here and the truck comes along, it vibrates, and that gives you sub-sized pixel vibrations, and the clarity is of course gone, or the sharpness. And note this down as well. It's in the metadata normally, but who knows what happens to them. It's not always the case that this survives a long pipeline. So I have set here some stuff. Of course, always write everything down that makes sense to you on a set, and you will see after a while it's very helpful to have the data that is not stored just here in the sidecar and in the metadata. It helps, and you get more and more an eye for the textures. It helps you to develop a sensitivity for the scene. I know this was maybe the most boring part in the whole series, at least I hope it was. Thanks for listening. Have fun with it. Bye bye.